Hey guys, it's Jason Snavely, certified wildlife biologist and founder and president of Drop-Tine Wildlife Consulting, the Drop-Tine Seed Company, and of course, Drop-Tine Podcast. Guys, I've 17 years private wildlife consultant, graduated from Mississippi State University, and one of the things I really enjoy doing is traveling the country and watching clients realize their dreams of taking a small piece of property and turning it into something really, really special. All right, welcome back. I'm going to throw you a bit of a curveball today. This is actually a podcast. I was just telling my guest today I've been wanting to do this for well over a year, and him and I have actually been trying to plan it for well over a year. It was an interest of mine, and then I was sitting at the dining room table of a client of mine in Indiana who was a regular listener to the podcast, and he asked about upcoming podcast episodes, and I said, I can succeed at my... He smiled, and he said, I'd love to hear that. When can you do that one? So, again, that was a year ago. I'm finally getting to it. I think it's definitely different from what our normal content is, but I think each and every one of you, likely, or at least most of you, is a member or a donor in a nonprofit organization. And, obviously I've been, since high school, a member of nonprofit organizations. There's so many of them out there: Rocky Mountain Elk Foundation, Trout Unlimited, National Wild Turkey Federation, QDMA, which is now obviously the NDA, Rough Grouse Society. Jeez, there's just so many of them. And I used to get every publication from all of them. And obviously, conservation owes a lot to many of these organizations. So this by no means is intended to slam any of these organizations, but I also know what it's like to have to earn your paycheck every week. So when I spend money, I try to be as aware as I can of where it's going, every penny of it. Hopefully my wife's not listening. She'll disagree with that. So anyway, I've been wanting to dig into nonprofit organizations, 501c3 organizations. And interestingly, nonprofit organizations do, in fact, make a profit. And our guest today will touch on that. So real quick, I want to get to our guest. Gary Dubas is a partner and director at McConley & Asbury, an accounting firm here in Pennsylvania. He is a key member of their affordable housing practice, and he spent over 30 years of public accounting, including 8 years with an international firm. He focuses a lot of his time servicing nonprofit, real estate, and affordable housing clients, as well as a number of growth-oriented companies. At McConley & Asbury, Gary's also a partner in charge of the nonprofit taxation practice, which obviously is why I chose Gary to visit with us today. And he also performs external peer reviews of accounting firms and oversees audits that fall under the reporting requirements of the Uniform Guidance and Government Auditing Standards. He obviously is a certified public accountant, educated, I believe, Gary will correct me, at Shippensburg University in Pennsylvania. And I will say, because his list of credentials and accomplishments go on for quite a while, this is obviously important for our conversation today. He serves on the Pennsylvania Association of Nonprofit Organizations Standards for Excellence Executive Committee. That's a mouthful. That's almost as long as my CWD terminology in the previous podcast. And by the way, real quick note on the CWD podcast, I appreciate all of the emails, texts, and phone calls from those of you who thanked me for the content. That is just the beginning of that topic. And I've spent, I would say hours, but days, just poring over the latest research, touching bases with everyone from the inferred origin up to the most recent research. So anyway, let's get on with nonprofit organizations and trying to determine how they spend our money and where. Gary, are you with me?
I am, certainly. Yes, I am, Jason.
Well, thank you for being with us today. I know you're used to giving talks and such on nonprofit organization analysis, and I don't know, a podcast on a wildlife conservation and management podcast is probably a bit out of the norm for you, but that's par for our course anyway.
Oh, that's fine. I enjoy doing this. As I said, I've been doing this for over 30 years. Love to be outdoors. I like to hike the forests around here in central Pennsylvania, and so glad to get together with you today, Jason.
Absolutely. Well, let's go ahead and get into it. I want the listener by the end of this podcast to be able to, on their own, look at the financials of a nonprofit organization and decide again on their own, hey, this is somewhere I want to put my money, right? I told you before this conversation that, you know, we are not here to slam any one organization or, whistleblow anybody. We're strictly here to teach the listener to make these decisions on their own. And, you know, I was never aware, well, until the last, I guess, decade of the Form 990. And when I became aware of the Form 990, it sort of becomes my my guide for who do I send money to and how successful are they at accomplishing their mission. So let's go ahead and get started, I guess. What if you're going to throw some of your hard-earned money, Gary, at an organization, what sort of things do you consider before you do that?
Sure. Yeah, I think the 990 is a great tool to be able to look at an organization that maybe you've been given to them for a little while. Maybe you're just getting introduced to the organization, and so the 990 is a great place to start. And you really, I like to, of course, as an accountant, I like to look at their fiscal health. I like to look at what their mission is and what kind of things are they currently accomplishing. So there's a number of things that I certainly look at to read between the lines and see if the organization is worth my dollar donation. That's for sure.
Perfect. And before we dive into that 990, I think I will sort of bring this up and let you comment on it, is that, you know, the maybe you can touch on what a 501c3 is and the fact that a nonprofit organization, what I think it goes back to the very basic inference of that terminology. Are they just donating their time, and, you know, what are they spending their money? Is it truly a nonprofit, or are they building assets and profit and spending them on other income producing assets? So isn't that sort of a false inference that a nonprofit is nonprofit?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, Jason. You know, one of the things that I work with my clients on is that are nonprofits is that, hey, you have to make a profit to continue to keep your doors open. You've got to generate financial resources to essentially deliver your mission and to do the things that you're doing for your clients or constituents. So, it's really true that, you know, when it comes to a nonprofit, you've got to balance the budget. And often donations are an important part of that. 501c3 organizations, that's just an internal revenue code reference when it comes to 501c3. Those are charitable organizations. And so they are mostly funded by general public or government contributions, et cetera. So it's really funded by the community, and it also you have tax deductions for giving those contributions to those organizations. So only 501c3 organizations are ones where you can get a tax deduction for a contribution. So you might be involved in an association like a state association or something similar to that. Those are often C6 organizations, and those are not tax deductible. Although, if your business gives to the organization for membership, that would be deductible, but not as a charitable contribution.
Good enough. And I will say here before I forget that this does not only relate to conservation. I mean, maybe you donate to the YMCA or Goodwill. In doing some of my research for this podcast, I looked up the Goodwill and the Salvation Army and the Y and those types of organizations. Again, all of those organizations file a 990 or some form of, and all these data apply to that situation as well, and other, you know, other industries and interests, et cetera. So, well, very good.
That's right.
Very, very good. So.
Yeah, that's right. And just wanted to say that, you know, when it comes to the 990, the easiest place to find them, and it's very comprehensive, is on the GuideStar website. GuideStar is a nonprofit organization themselves, and on their GuideStar.org website, you can tap into any 990 that's been filed over the last 3 years for any organization. GuideStar gets directly from the IRS the 990s, and they put them out there on the website. And it's free. You can pull those 990s up for any organization that is not only C3s, but all nonprofit organizations. So, you know, if you're ever curious about, looking at a national organization like we're going to talk about today, that's the place where you can get these 990s.
Yeah, no, I'm glad you mentioned that, because when I started looking for 990s, obviously you can jump online and search for them. Some are easier to find than others, obviously outside of that GuideStar website. And I've also noticed, for what this is worth, that some organizations, for instance, Ducks Unlimited, are very transparent about their audited financials, including their Form 990. So if you go to Ducks Unlimited's website, they have a whole page dedicated to their audited financials, their 990s, from fiscal year, probably the last 3 years, I think. So that, to me, that in and of itself is impressive, that they're willing to show it. And I guess this is one area, or maybe this is the time to mention, I did this week leading up to this, I made some calls to some of the more popular nonprofit organizations in conservation. And I labeled a bunch of them there at the beginning of the podcast and asked the individual answering the phone, whoever they chose that to be, if they could please email me a Form 990. And it's rather entertaining, the response you get on the other end of the line. Some organizations, knew what that was. Obviously, most of the folks who answered the phone passed me on to a chief financial officer of some sort, and all very, very accommodating for the most part. One sent me an updated 2020, I think it was, 990, which I sent you. That was incomplete, which was sort of odd to me. And another gal told me to just Google it without sending it to me. I thought that was kind of uncomfortable. I prefaced all this with, hi, you know, this is who this is. I'm considering, you know, joining and donating to organization, because I am. I'm at a point where I literally cut all of them. And I was just getting so much mail, and I was a member of everything. And a couple of them I wasn't overly satisfied with. So I cut them all and decided to start vetting them from square one. And rejoin. So I sort of, you know, sold it as, hey, listen, this is what I'm looking to do. I want to see your 990. I want to look at your fiscal responsibility. I want to look at, you know, where your revenues, your expenses, your contributions, your compensation is important to me. It may not be overly important to you, but if I'm donating to enhance ruffed grouse habitat, I want that money to go to ruffed grouse habitat. Now, obviously, if you know they have to put on banquets, etc., to fundraise and raise more money, I understand you have to spend money there as well. But I also want to see where the money goes, and I want to see results. That's my big thing. So, again, some of these are on the organization's website. Pretty easy to find. Others you have to dig and dig, unless you use the tip Gary just offered, the GuideStar website. So
that's right. That's great. You connected with those organizations and the reactions that you got. That does give you a little bit of sense of what the organization is like. The more transparent in my world, you know, the better off you're going to feel as a donor, without a doubt.
Yeah, and I didn't expect the individual answering the phone to know what a 990 was, but I certainly wanted to be put in touch with somebody who was willing to email it to me rather quickly, and most of them were, but some of them told me just Google it, just go find it yourself, and of course I did. Okay.
Exactly.
Yeah, so let's dive into this 990. So obviously, you know, first of all, how many pages is it? And you know, the minute you pull up the 990, don't lose your mind. Yeah, it looks like your tax return. Don't get too excited. You don't really need to look at some of these are 50 pages long, I think, Gary, but there are certain areas that I've sort of come accustomed to just zoning in on immediately.
That's right. Right. You know, they can be 50 plus pages, even more, with the required disclosures when it comes to a 990. So there is a lot of information, without a doubt, in a 990. And in today's world, you want to be able to focus and look at, hey, what's really relevant to me? Because there's a lot of information that is disclosed in the 990. So if you want to do, I'll walk through one organization here, Jason, and I'll point out some, you know, some things to look for.
Yes, sir. And again, we created a number system so we didn't have to mention the organization. I don't want to do that when Gary's here. He's too much of a professional. So in the future, I can reveal these. If you have a question about, you know, I don't know which one Gary picked, but let's say we're talking about number three and the fact that their compensation percentage seems pretty high based on their revenue, email me. And, you know, maybe in the future, we'll just start talking about each one of these individually, certainly not looking to cause any harm. But what number are you starting with, Gary, so I can pull it up?
Let's go ahead and start with number one.
Okay. Fair enough.
Okay. So, as in the interest of time, we're going to look at what I think are things that the average citizen will look at when it comes to a 990. So this particular one that we're going to start with, you know, again, national organization in the conservation area, and the first page provides an executive summary for the reader. It provides a lot of information, financial information, you know, regarding revenues, expenses, and assets, et cetera. This particular organization, right off the bat, gave me pause for concern. You're required to fill out all the information, but this particular 990, you're required to, at the top of near the top of the page, put the year of formation in it, and also the state of legal domicile. This one does not have any information in those two slots. So that started me to think a little bit about the organization. You know, as an accountant, you know, you want to fill this out totally and accurately. Also, in the very bottom of the first page, you have the preparer of the 990, and it discloses the date that it was filed. And interestingly, this one was filed on a November 18th day, and they're actually due no later than November 15th for a calendar year 990. So If those dates are correct, they were going to be penalized for filing late. So that's another a little bit of a red flag right off the bat when you're looking at page one.
Okay. So are extensions granted, perhaps, or no?
They are, yes. Their original due date is for a calendar year is May 15th, and then you can quickly file. It takes all about 2 minutes to file an extension to then get another 6 months to November 15th. So, and that's the latest you can file the 990 for.
Okay.
And again, just using a calendar year reporting entity.
So I was not a great student until college, but deadlines generally meant you failed if you handed in your term paper or your test or whatever after your report after the deadline. Were they penalized financially for that?
They would. So if you do file it after the extended due date of November 15th, you will then quickly get a IRS notice, and they will fine you. You know, essentially penalize you an amount, $100 essentially or more per day for late filing. And so, there right off the bat, you know, you're potentially paying a penalty for late filing. And there goes some of your mission funds to pay the IRS. Now, the IRS is relatively forgiving for nonprofits, you know. If you file it like this one, you filed it 3 days late, they'll probably remove the penalty, you know, but you've got to get your accountant to write a letter, you know, and you got to work with the IRS to get that removed. So,
right.
Yeah.
So that might be a potential. Okay. So first of all, you mentioned it was incomplete. Second of all, the filing date was past due. I mean, we're talking fiscal responsibility. Who knows what went on? I don't know, but there's still some, you know, at 30 or 35 bucks a member, if you're just a paying member, you receive a magazine, et cetera, there's 8 or 9 members right there. If they were, in fact, fined $300, that's not really where I want my membership money going. So I guess the other thing I want to point out, I wasn't sure what year you were talking about for this organization number one until you started mentioning the incomplete nature of the Form 990. This is the organization I reached out to via telephone and was forwarded on to their chief financial officer, who was very polite, by the way, and emailed me a copy of the 990. So this 990 was not just dug up online by me. It was emailed to me by their chief financial officer, and then obviously I forwarded it to Gary to prepare a little bit today, and he sent me an email back and said, this one's kind of concerning because there's several things that are not disclosed and it's incomplete, and obviously we'll get to the compensation bit here soon. So I just wanted to point that out that, you know, these days with the internet, you can go find all kinds of stuff online, so I didn't want to get emails from people saying, well, maybe that number one, you know, maybe that was just an incomplete. And by the way, it was, in fact, signed by the CFO on that same day, 11/18/2021. And that's the individual with whom I spoke and received the 990 from. Gary brought up the preparer. The preparer is a certified public accountant who obviously assisted them with this. So what else, Gary?
Yeah, so that's the first page of the 990. On page two is where you really disclose your program, your mission, activities that happened over that year that you're filing it. So looking at the year 2020 for this organization, there are areas where you're required to disclose your main accomplishments for each of your three major programs that you have within your organization. And so in this particular 990, It just says see Schedule O on it. And there's essentially no disclosures on this particular page. So to me, that's also a little it kind of catches my eye, is that, you know, Schedule O is where you can continue if you want to expand on the amount of space that's available on page two. But just to say see Schedule O, you're putting back into, way back into the filing, information that a reader wants to look at regarding, hey, what did you accomplish this year? And so that was a little programmatic or problematic when I saw that. Now, they disclosed quite a bit of information and very good relevant information back on Schedule O, mm-hmm, of 990. But again, it looks like it was kind of a little bit of a hurried, again, they filed it late. It looks like they were down to the deadline, and then they kind of imported a bunch of information that they had readily available and just kind of threw it in there on Schedule O. So that was a little concerning when I saw that.
Yeah. I just finally found Schedule O on my laptop, and it's four pages
right,
long. I don't, yeah. Okay.
Fair enough. Yeah. So, and this is often, this page is often, when it comes to your program activities, a great opportunity to advertise and to really promote your organization, to say, hey, here's the great things that we're doing, and do it relatively briefly, but let the reader know, the potential donor know, hey, we've got some dynamic things going on.
And that's a good point. I guess it, obviously this was also prepared by an accountant, or from an assistant by an accountant, and sort of reminds me of writing I like to read a lot of peer-reviewed literature, which goes on, and it's, there's a lot of statistics, and you have to sort through to find basically the take-home. I see what you're saying about this section here, because, a lot of us lose interest after, and we're on page one, there's already some concerns. Now we're on the very top of page two, which I'm going to get to most of the time. And like you said, that's their opportunity to talk about what pulls my heartstrings, which is ensuring the continuation of, whether it's deer hunting, deer management, et cetera. And I've, Schedule O is, oh my gosh, the details are just, it gets lost in their Schedule O. Like you said, I forget what page it is down at the bottom. So yeah, I see what you're saying. I never really noticed that before. And I've been referred to Schedule O on a 990 before. I'm sure you'll get to this, but I just want to throw this out there before I forget. When they ask for the declaration of like independent contractors, et cetera, who they've paid throughout that reporting term, whether it's for marketing, advertising, to give speeches or promote their business, or, contractors, et cetera. There's so many, and sometimes it's only those who they paid $100,000 or more. And there's so many of those firms that they have it on Schedule O. So you have to go to that and sort through all these, if it's a conservation group, it might be a forestry or a habitat improvement firm, et cetera. And it just blows my mind. And that's only those that they've paid over $100,000, by the way. So any 99,000 and below, there could be any number of those out there.
That's right. Yeah, absolutely. That's exactly right. Like I said, there's a lot of information, especially for a real large organization. There's a lot of things that are required to be disclosed, without a doubt. So that was kind of page two of the 990. I'll have us flip forward to page seven.
Yep.
And this is where, on page seven and page eight, is where you're required to disclose your board members, your officers, key employees, and highest compensated employees that meet certain criteria. So you have to disclose all of your board members. You've got to disclose your officers. And officers, include your CEO or executive director, whatever title you have, and also your CFO, controller, accounting manager, et cetera. You're required to disclose both of them on this form. Again, as well as key members of your organization. And this particular form, both the CFO and the CEO are disclosed in there, but there's no compensation disclosed. Although, for some reason, there's a subtotal of $171,000 that's disclosed on page 8 of this 990, but it doesn't refer to any particular individuals. So,
yeah,
that was really concerning when I looked at that. You know, again, it looks like it's a hurried process to get this 990 done, and they did not even disclose, you know, who the compensation actually belonged to.
Yeah, I think page 7 and 8 and a couple pages after that is really, to me, where the rubber meets the road as a small business owner, CEO, CFO, chief bottle washer, garbage guy, furniture mover, et cetera, for 21 years is I take money seriously, and this is other people's money, and I would take other people's money even more seriously. So this is how they choose to, and don't get me wrong, I fully relate to how much work the CEO and CFO probably do, or they do, for these organizations. It's a massive amount of work. Let's see, the CEO of this one reports 38 hours a week. I'm sure he puts in more than that. The CFO, I've lost the CFO, 38 hours a week, probably more than that. So I get that, but this was one that concerned me as well and actually surprised me, because here we are, you know, the same organization, number one, that has all of these inconsistencies and just deletions from the 990. But I wanted to see, I was actually considering jumping back in with this one and joining and sending them some money. But it was disappointing. And by the way, $171,000, whether you think that's a lot or a little, that's none of my business, but that's generally, that's pretty accurate for what a CEO for a nonprofit, a conservation nonprofit organization gets paid annually. So that in and of itself may or may not be a surprise to you. I don't know. And there's actually many that are much higher than that. So just, again, something that's important. And Gary, I'm going to let you go after that. I'm just going to let you go on, and I'm making notes on things that I want to bring up.
Sure. So we'll go to page 9 of the 990, and it's this statement of revenues. And this breaks out the revenues of the organization into various categories: contributions, program service revenues, and so this is an area that's interesting to be able to see what is the diversity of their revenues. You know, and this particular organization, $2.7 million of $3.8 million are contributions. $445,000 of the contributions are from government grants. So it gives you an indication that they're getting money from the government. So this is, again, this is also interesting to be able to see, you know, how sophisticated they are. Are they relying totally on contributions, or are they doing some things when it comes to program revenues? So this particular organization very heavily is being funded by contributions.
Mm-hmm. And those contributions can come from individuals or firms or both?
Right. That's right. Exactly.
Okay.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. So, again, here's an organization, that disclosed, you know, that most of their revenues are coming from you know, not program activities, fees that they're generating from actual mission activities, mostly from contributions. So something to look at and keep in mind.
So if this particular organization puts a lot of financial resources into fundraising via banquets, is that a wise allocation of financial resources? Do you think those contributions come from the banquets, or do you think the bulk of those come from cocktail parties and meetings in boardrooms somewhere where maybe an organization, a firm, an individual is looking for quote unquote tax deductions?
Sure. Yeah, you know, this particular the statement of revenues of the 990 will, if you have fundraising events, will require you to disclose those separately. That ends up on Jason on line 8A, 8B of the form. So they have not disclosed that they have done any fundraising events. They haven't done an annual dinner. They haven't done public meeting, something, again, that annual conference for your members. So this is suggesting as well that they're not doing a whole lot when it comes to fundraising in terms of reaching out to the public in a special event fashion.
Yeah, so, now I will say, not to interrupt you, but in all fairness, yeah. I neither like nor dislike this organization, but this is, and they have not disclosed, like you said, at the very beginning of this, the dates with which this reports, but this is pretty close to the COVID pandemic, and obviously fundraising via banquets and public, large public gatherings was not a thing. So I don't know. Perhaps that could be it, because in years past, and obviously, we have those. And that's the sort of thing that you can, learn to dig into, as you go through it.
Yeah, that's a great point. That's right. This would have been pandemic timing of 2020 calendar year. So very good point about that, that they were kind of holding tight, like many other businesses and nonprofits were doing. So, yeah, that's a very good point, without a doubt. We can move on to we'll move on to the next page, which is the statement of functional expenses, page mm-hmm. 10.
Yep.
And this is another page that donors will focus in on. This breaks out your total expenses into the three categories: program expenses, management and general expenses, and fundraising expenses. And the biggest thing that when you look quickly at a 990 and you look on this page, you're looking to see how much of their total expenses are for program mission-driven expenses. So this particular organization had a total of $2.8 million of total expenses, and $2,035,000 of those were program expenses, which equates to 72% of their total expenses were for program activities. And I think it's a great point that Jason has, maybe this particular year may not be totally indicative of the organization because of the pandemic, but that's a relatively low percentage of program activities versus management, general, and fundraising. They had over $600,000 of management general expenses in 2020. So what this equates to, the 72% of program service expenses basically means that for every dollar that you give to the organization, 72 cents of that will go to program activities, but the other 28 cents or so would go to overhead, fundraising and management general. We like to see at least 80% 75 to 80% for sure in those ranges in terms of program activities. The lower the you know, the non-program activities expenses are, obviously the better, that they're really spending most of their time on mission-driven activities. So that's something that donors will look at right off the bat.
Okay, fair enough. And again, maybe that's something, you know, if you're a current member and you look and you see, you know, a concern, and then maybe, you know, you come up with some potential plausible explanations that they were handcuffed and handicapped during, you know, those COVID years, that gives you something to look at and wait for. You know, some of these firms still haven't really released their latest 990. So, you know, maybe next year before you up your membership or donate, maybe you'll pull up the most recent and see if they've trended in a much more desirable direction. And I think that's probably more important than any 1 year, is that they're, you know, kind of trending in the right direction. And then the other thing you could do, obviously we're looking at the 2020, we could easily bounce back, which I pulled it up. I have so many 990s up here, I'm confusing myself. But, and it's not easy to go from a PDF to, you know, I have 12 of them up and then go through 50 pages, but we could pull up a 2017 once you're done going through this, and, you know, or 18 even, you know, and sort of compare and contrast.
Yeah, that's exactly right. When you're doing this, and that's what GuideStar always has, at least 3 years, of 990s on there for you to look at, because they understood that process, is that, hey, you know, you want to look at multiple years of activities for sure to get a sense of what the organization is doing. So, I mean, I think that's a real good point, because, again, we're looking at, you know, again, a year that maybe some things were a little more challenging, you know, than other years for sure. So, the next page of the 990 is the balance sheet, and this really gives you a sense of what the financial resources of the organization are as of the end of their fiscal year, end of the calendar year for this organization. This particular organization had a significant decrease from year to year, because it's a comparative balance sheet. This one's comparing 2019 to 2020, and they had a significant decrease in their assets overall, from $5.8 million down to $3.7 million. And again, you know, again, pandemic-wise, that certainly may have had some impact in it. But that's something that certainly jumps out, and that's where you'd want to look at, you know, again, the organization over a number of years.
Right, and there's a lot of pulling out of context here too. It may not be a legitimate explanation. It, you know, obviously a potential. But the other thing with this particular organization that I had kept an eye on before anyone knew what COVID-19 was, is it had experienced a decline in overall analysis of the 990 from several points. Let's just start with revenue was on the decline. And at the same time, contribution or pay compensation to its CEO was increasing. And as a private business owner, entrepreneur, I'm thinking, well, you know, you go back to 2008, if anybody was in business back then, a lot of us, you know, we worked harder to make just as much or more, because obviously the economy sucked and it was harder to make money. So I certainly didn't give myself a pay increase. If anything, I cut back significantly on spending. And, you know, large companies, even long, you know, companies that have been around a long time for generations, were issuing furloughs and layoffs, and a lot of people were going through a lot of pain. And unfortunately, our economy is headed back to that point. But when I see an organization's revenue declining, total assets decreasing, yet the CEO's compensation is increasing, I've got the science mind, so I'm willing to try to interpret what that could be, but to me that just doesn't make a lot of sense. Now, there was a change in leadership about that time as well.
Sure, that's right. You know, and again, that's something that you can look at when you compare, you know, 990s from a couple of years. You know, hey, how long has the CEO been there? Have they been reported on several 990s, or are they in the midst of a transition when you see a different CEO reported on the 990? You know, so those were the things that kind of jumped out on this particular 990. And those are the things, in a way, those categories are the areas that are most often looked at, you know, for a 990. You know, so this one just happened to be one where, the first one is one where you're scratching your head a little bit about the of what's going on with the organization as reported on the 990.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Can you touch on the fact that, I guess, going back up to page 8, I've put a lot of weight on how much the CEO is compensated based on the revenue. Obviously, being results driven as a self-employed individual, $171,000, and that's what I went to do the computation on this one. And I said, well, wait a minute, $171,000 is the total, but I don't know who to, you know, give that to. Is that the CEO? Is that the CFO? I'm assuming that's the CEO, but there are at least two individuals who invest over, you know, well, they're at 38 hours a week. So I'm sure this other individual with 38 hours is taking some sort of compensation. But I guess just looking at the total compensation of $171,000 in relation to, going back to page 1, the total revenue of $3.8 million as a percentage, is there a number that you're looking for, whether it's just the CEO or the total of all reported?
That's a good question. I mean, I typically look, I just generally look at the size of the organization, you know, and also especially the budget of the organization. When I say that, the total expenses. So they had $2.8 million of expenses that particular year. Anything that's over, you know, $1 million as a nonprofit organization is a relatively decent size. And so, you know, you have to look at the diversity of activities that they're doing, as well as that total budget, and then kind of look at it and say, determine whether that compensation makes sense. For, like I said, if you've got $1 million or $2 million plus, or higher, then you're generally going to be, for a CEO, in today's world, you're going to be in the $125,000 to $175,000 range. Yeah, you know, just based on that budget size.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know, so.
Okay.
Yeah. And, you know, it goes up from there, that's for sure.
Yep.
But, yeah.
Okay. Well, very good. I guess we can jump to number 3. Were you done with that 990?
I was, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, there's more on there that I, you know, you could, but I'll leave that. I think the listener now has enough information, if they didn't fall asleep, to go through that and say, yeah, this looks pretty good. There were some surprises on that one for sure. But if we go on to number 3.
Okay.
That's going to take me a minute. Tell me when you're there. And
this is a 2019 one.
Okay. Yep.
Of this organization. And this one organization, you know, it overall looks very solid in terms of their disclosures. You know, I think they have good disclosures. So right off the bat, on the first page, you know, it looks like an organization that's relatively stable. Now, they did have on line 19 on the first page, they did have a loss in 2019, $222,000. Mm-hmm. Year before, they had a positive number of $767,000 of net income. So, Things happen from year to year without a doubt. They had a lot of program service revenues the year before and not quite as much in the 2019 year. So, but everything is complete in terms of the presentation of the 990. So, you know, nothing real earth-shattering jumped out at me.
Yeah, so the dates are disclosed at the top. July 1 of 19 ending June 30 of 2020. So that was a positive, right? Check.
Yep, that's right. That's right. Yeah.
And the revenue in the current year is what, 7 million?
The current year total revenues were $7 million. That's right.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So the prior year was 9.5, so again a bit of a hit, but you know, is it a trend or is it a one-year, you know, outlier, I guess, is the question.
That's right. Okay.
Fair enough. That's moving right on.
Yeah. So, I thought page two, I thought they were pretty transparent in terms of their disclosures regarding their program activities. So I thought that made me feel pretty good. And compensation, you know, just kind of jumps out, you know, on page seven of this 990, you know, a couple of interesting things of this particular organization when we look on page seven when mm-hmm. it comes to officers, directors, et cetera, is, first of all, the first two people that are disclosed on it, the executive director and a vice president, are related. So that's interesting to see that you have related people involved in the organization at the highest level with the executive director and vice president. Now they only have board members for this organization, and it's a decent sized organization. They only have four board members, and one of those board members is the executive director, which is unusual. Usually the CEO or the executive director is not a board member, voting board member. So that gives a decent amount of power to the executive director if you are part of the board and you're in that decision-making process at that level. So it's an interesting dynamic that this organization has regarding its overall governance. Kind of interesting. They also have a number of compensated individuals.
You just hit the main reason I've never joined this organization, because it's historically had, oh my gosh, eight or more individuals over $100,000 annually. And that, as you mentioned, the executive director and the vice president have the same last name. One of them declares 5 hours a week, but makes $39,000 plus another $2,200 in other compensation, which maybe you can touch on that eventually too. So, yeah, sorry. I just wanted to say, that's what bothers me, is that there's so many individuals with six-figure salaries. Again, whether that's high or not for you is not the point. It's an individual decision.
That's right. Exactly. Right, lots of highly compensated individuals, a very small board. Again, just four directors, board of directors, of which each of those board of directors is compensated. It's a very interesting dynamic for a national organization to have such a small board and then have compensation at the board level as well as the staff level. So those things definitely jumped out without a doubt. If you go to the statement of revenues. This organization shows quite a bit of diversity in terms of its revenues, and that's, I think that's an overall good thing. That means you're you're a relatively dynamic organization. You don't want to just totally rely on donors. They've got $405,000 of program service management member dues. Mm-hmm. They've got fundraising activities, also special events that they generate $3.9 million of revenues. They've got some magazine advertising income also in there. They've got a number of things, a little bit more than the previous organization. That is diversity of their revenues, which is I think is a positive thing. Mm-hmm.
Do you feel, before you go on there, do you feel like that total, and I wanted to go to section B, but their total compensation was what, $1,122,000, and I think they were a $7 million revenue. So is that, as a percentage, what is that? Your podcast, by the way, is the only one I've ever had a calculator sitting here. and I am not a numbers guy, which is why I have smart accountants like you, but... $1,122,000 divided by the 7. Yeah, like 16-17% somewhere in there. Is that high?
That's a pretty high number. 7.2 million dollars was their total expenses as well for that year. So, it's a pretty high number, yeah, without a doubt. Definitely makes you think about.
I like the name of both of these two organizations, and I really like the species. I like all game and non-game species, but I really like the species, and I'd love to be a part of helping improve that conservation effort. But I guess that's one of the reasons I wanted to have you on, is I struggle looking at how other people. Spend money. Other people's money.
Yeah, exactly. If we go on to page 10 again with the statement of functional expenses, this particular organization has 90% reported as program service expenses. So they're saying is that those pretty well compensated individuals are working significantly on the mission of the organization. They're not spending as much time in the management in general and fundraising activities. When you step back, that's certainly a positive. 9 out of every 10 cents, are going towards the mission of the organization. Mm-hmm. Now I can tell you as an accountant, sometimes doing this particular schedule, it's very, very judgmental. Whether they're it's totally accurate or not, it's hard to say. But they have a large firm that did the 990, and so a very reputable firm, mm-hmm. and so I look at that with some pretty good credence that they're. That they're focused in on their mission, without a doubt.
Okay.
Yeah. And then one other thing that when it comes to the organization size-wise, on the balance sheet on page 11, they've got this organization has $11.1 million of total assets, of which they have almost $5.4 million of savings in temporary cash investments. So. They've got a lot of liquid cash, that's something that certainly jumps out to me as well. To me, when you're hoarding, I don't want to say hoarding, but when you've got that much cash on hand, mm-hmm. then you certainly think and say, hey, do they need any of my contributions anytime soon?
Right.
But at the same time, they might be generating that cash so that they can, go into a new facility or expand their programs with additional investments into their program. So it just causes you to think about mm-hmm. and maybe question. And that's where, Ben, I always say, hey, look at their website along with this information so that, and you'll see if they have new initiatives or, hey, they've got a big capital campaign because they're going to expand a wing of their building or something to that effect. So these things will make you question, and then you want to look into it a little bit further.
Okay. Fair enough.
Okay.
I guess we could.
Maybe we could
breeze real quickly. This took longer than I was hoping to keep you, but maybe you can just from a. Maybe you're not going to invest a significant amount of money, but just glance at number four. How does that sort of 2020 for number four? Just what would you do in a, you know, I guess you have, maybe you have 10 minutes in your office and you're thinking about renewing.
Yeah, I think that I think this particular organization comes across, you know, very, very well, very solid organization. And, you know, again, I look at relatively decent transparency, you know, when it comes to their 990 in terms of disclosing information. So, nothing necessarily jumped out. Now they had about a $4 million budget, expenses, and, you know, their compensation for their CEO was about $175,000. So, a larger, considerably larger, twice as large as the first one we talked about, in terms of operating expenses, but a very similar compensation to, so that looks pretty reasonable to me as well with the size of the organization. So
that president and CEO, I've seen this a lot. He, under reportable compensation, he's at $174,000. And then his, let's see, there's other compensation to the tune of $28,000+. What is other compensation? Is that a credit card through the organization, or is that dental bills? What is that?
What it is, it's usually for most organizations, it's an estimated cost of the health insurance that's provided to them on an annual basis. And also, if the organization has a retirement plan, what the organization contributes to the retirement plan.
Okay.
So that's typically what that other compensation is. So, of course, the cost of health insurance today is not cheap. So $28,000 overall seems like a relatively reasonable number for other compensation. But, yeah, you look at both the $174,000 and $28,000, you know, it's not a bad compensation for a nonprofit CEO.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I happen to know that one. And went to school with them. There's not too many wildlifers making that much money in the industry, so it is. All right. Well, fair enough. I think there's obviously some other things on that 990 that I'd looked at, but is there anything else you see on that one?
I think one of the things is that from a financial size organization, they have overall $11 million in total assets. So a decent sized organization. And back on Schedule D, page two, they disclose their endowment funds.
Yeah.
And without getting into too technical accounting terminology, those are funds that are set aside, but donors for the organization set aside for future activities. And they had 100%, they had a $6 million endowment, which was board designated. So they had money that they really were setting aside as an endowment. My guess is they probably had a reason for that they were going to utilize those funds in the future for something very specific, or maybe it was just for annual operating expenses. But that's an interesting thing. That shows some real substance to the organization, without a doubt.
So. Mm-hmm. And this organization's been around since 1961. So unless you have any more, of course, I'll let you wrap up with whatever. I've kept you longer. I thought this would be 30 minutes, but apparently I'm not good at that. But they've been around since 1961. So one conversation I've had with clients and peers is how do you assess their, you know, their accomplishments, and how do you know if they're accomplishing what they should be based on those financial parameters? So, you know, this 990 overall looks pretty decent. They've been doing it since 1961. They seem fiscally responsible. They're dedicated to one or two, game species. So would you expect that particular species to be doing, and I know you're not really a hunter per se, I don't think, and I'm just kind of, this is a conversation. Would you expect that particular species to be doing good? In other words, you know, flourishing, hunters have plenty of surplus animals to harvest. Or would you expect that animal to be, you know, struggling, perhaps not, you know, endangered or threatened, but should there be any sort of continuum or expectation that, okay, if this species is no longer doing well and we're shutting down seasons, maybe we're just making a bunch of money and being fiscally responsible, but we're not attacking the right, you know, approach or you know, the lower hole, so to speak, in the barrel.
Right. No, I think that's a real good point, you know, without a doubt, is what is the organization still doing, you know, for their members, for the good of society, so to speak, or are they kind of going through some motions and just spending money on kind of old news, so to speak. So, I think those are good things to definitely look at.
Excellent. Anything else you have? I have a summary if you don't.
No, I appreciate the opportunity to talk with you, Jason. This has been fun. I love going through these 990s, and it's amazing what you can come up with when you look at these documents. And and just a real quick thing regarding McConnelly and Asbury, we do over 150 nonprofit organizations. We work in many different industries and got three locations here in Pennsylvania, Bloomsburg, Camp Hill, outside of Harrisburg, and Lancaster. So we appreciate the opportunity to jump on with you today, Jason.
Absolutely. And likewise, I and the listeners appreciate your content knowledge. You're clearly sharp in that regard. And I, too, have a strange and unique fascination with the 990s now. Once you start to compare and contrast, it's kind of interesting to see how people spend other people's money, and it's rather interesting to watch them spend their own money. But I guess in summary, talked about a lot of things. Probably some folks had some flashbacks to their accounting classes. If you were to pick, you know, do a real quick summary, you know, three or four things. I know you just mentioned a whole bunch. To assess the overall health, what are some things you'd look at on the 990 and maybe the website or whatever?
I think you want to look at the page 2, their program service accomplishments. Want to see what they're doing, how they're disclosing that information, being transparent. You want to look at the diversity of revenues. And then I think you want to look at their functional expenses. You want to see how much money are they spending on overhead, so to speak, versus their actual mission. So those are the things that jump out. And, of course, you want to see that they're not overly compensating their key executives. That certainly jumps out as well.
Excellent. Well, very good. I appreciate all your time. And, for the listeners, I we could do more based on the feedback. We can get further in depth, or we can leave it right here and let you take it from here
and conduct your own due diligence before you spend any money or send any money. So anyway, thanks, Gary. Appreciate you. And
all right. You're very welcome.
Yes, sir. So it's July the 8th. I hope everybody's summer squatch is getting squatchy or thinking about it. We are actually actively developing, improving, and remixing, reblending for next year already and looking at feedback. One of the things I love most about being a small company is being able to receive immediate feedback from you, the listener, the customer, the user of our products. So, and if you don't get an email back, I love addressing these emails and trying to get it to as many as I can. The feedback is what makes the company so great, not something that we're doing behind the scenes and, you know, some magical mix that obviously that research helps, but the feedback from your end, too much of this species, not enough of that species. We need a blend. We can crimp terminate to create, you know, more plant residue, maybe region specificity. I've got some podcasts coming up with some clients from South Carolina. I enjoy the Piedmont and its challenges down there, and then obviously other sections of the country as well. So again, thank you for all that. Keep the feedback coming. Here's where I ask you to go on the podcast app and rate us. And obviously those reviews are super fun to read and super helpful. So if you can leave a review, appreciate that. I will be picking more of those in the future and sending seed hats and sweatshirts, etc. So appreciate all that. And until next time, thank you so much.
Just a good old boy, never meaning no harm. Beats all you never saw, been in trouble with the law since the day they was born. Straightening the curves, yeah, flattening the hills. Someday the mountain might get them, but the law never will. Making their way, the only way they know how. That's just a little bit more than the law will allow. She don't understand, they keep her showing my hands and not my face on TV.